Hello, Voices from the Bench community. Pat Kuhn from Ivoclar here. Innovation and education are inseparable partners in our profession, where continuous change offers you the opportunity to raise the bar of dental care and elevate what is clinically and technically possible. So we at Ivoclar have created Ivoclar Academy, where we support you through cutting-edge educational programs and resources. We understand that you have busy schedules and individual preferences for learning. To help leverage your time and maximize your learning experience, the Academy has educational opportunities that are easily accessible and fit any learning style. Whether you are looking for an in-person program or for virtual education, Ivoclar Academy offers multi-channel opportunities that allow you to learn at home, in the classroom, in the office, or on the go. In addition, we offer CE-accredited learning opportunities. You can receive a certificate of attendance for each CE-eligible program or training course completed from the Ivoclar Academy. Simply log on to ivoclar.com and click on the Academy link located at the top of the page to get started. Happy learning.
Welcome to Voices from the Bench, a dental laboratory podcast. Send us an email at info@voicesfromthebench.com and follow us on Facebook and Instagram. Greetings and welcome to episode 313 of Voices from the Bench. My name is Elvis.
And my name is Barbara.
Who survived camping last week? How was it?
Not only did I survive, but I thrived and I enjoyed myself. And I can definitely say that I unplugged.
Nice.
Like, really unplugged. There's something about the trees and the nature and just not having to do anything that I really enjoyed.
Except burning marshmallows, right? I mean.
Oh, I burned those motherfuckers. Yes, I did. I absolutely did. And I was mesmerized by the fire. You could sit me by a fire like for hours and I don't have to talk or do anything. So yes, thank you for asking.
Yeah, I was waiting to hear on the news about a forest fire in Florida caused by marshmallows, but I'm glad everything was okay.
I've got pictures of them. I'll send them to you.
Yeah, please do. I had a crazy week. We talk on this podcast a lot about smart denture conversion. We've had Dr. Kaufman on. We've had tons of people talk about it. I actually had to do one on Friday.
How'd it go?
It was pretty decent. Not my best. As I explained to the prosthodontist, it's been about 8 months since I've done one, so we'll learn together.
That is fantastic.
Yeah, it started at 7:30, and at 12:30, I had to take off, so I was left to polish, handed it to her, and said good luck.
Well, good for you.
Yeah, it's fun. I always like to remind people that I do work.
I know you do, a lot. I can say that.
I don't just play on Facebook and...
Oh, well, you do that a lot, and everybody knows it, so stop.
I do that.
So what's up?
So everybody knows that we're heading to Spain in May for the
ExoCAD
Insight meeting. Yeah, yes. I saw a post that ExoCAD did this week that said 1 month and 14 days. I'm like, oh my God. I am
crazy.
So ready, not ready.
I'm ready.
Yeah, I am too. But make sure you head over to exocad.com/insights2024 to register and hang out with us on a beautiful Spanish island. But we're also super happy and excited to announce that Barb and I, we're going to be back in Florida.
I'm in Florida.
You're already in there, Florida. I get to go to Florida for the FDLA meeting that's happening June 7th and 8th, thanks to the good people at Jensen Dental.
Thank you, Jensen Dental.
Yeah, this is amazing.
I'm going to be doing dual, just so you know. I'm on the FDLA board, so I'm going to be going back and forth and back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, but yes.
Understood. You have obligations. It's going to be good. We haven't recorded at FDLA in
three, four years.
Yeah. It's been a hot minute. I've been there with Preet since then, but since we've had the podcast, it's been a while. And we're really looking forward to recording at, honestly, one of the greatest state meetings that our industry has left.
I would definitely really like to say the FDLA really is excellent. Danielle Wunsche, she's unbelievable. She's our leader, and we have a lot of conference calls, and the lineup's amazing, and I'm stoked.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to be working. We're doing a panel, but it's going to be a walking around sort of question and answer session. I think it's on Friday. So I'm excited.
Are you on stage or are you walking around with the mic?
I think a little bit of both.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's exciting. I had no idea.
Yeah, guys. So if Spain is not in your budget, please go to Florida. Visit fdla.net. Check out the schedule. Like, it's all technical. Amazing. Friday's the business meeting. It's just super great. So always one to not miss.
Awesome. So it wasn't long ago when we were with 4,999 of our closest friends in Chicago at LMT Lab Day. Of course, we were set up thanks to the good people at Ivoclar. Go buy their stuff.
Go Ivoclar.
Yep, we were in their ballroom all weekend talking pretty much to anybody that came by. Now, we know that many people came by to record with us while we were recording, and we're sorry we didn't have the time to get to you. But please feel free to reach out to set up a date to record, or we can do it at another show that we'll be at. Hint, 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 Spain and Florida. So usually, when we do Lab Day Chicago, I have to rearrange all the recordings just to fit them into episodes for timing. But this year, it's kind of cool. It worked out that we're basically playing them all in order, except for one.
Oh, my God, that was so
cool. Yeah, so you're really going to get a good sense of the vibe of the show, how the days played out, and basically how hoarse our voice was near the end talking so much.
Mm-hmm.
So first up this week is part of Barb's A-Team.
Boom-yah.
Michael Wandling. Michael has played a big part in writing the questions for the CDT tests and has only one left to go before he becomes a master dental technician himself.
Shout out.
That's huge.
Honestly, that's
huge. I mean, people talk about taking one test. I can't imagine what, 4 or 5 you have to do?
Yeah.
Nuts. He talks about his history, working with Barb to write the test, being an examiner, and how he had to self-teach himself in the areas that he isn't already good at.
Yeah. And then we get to visit with Vinod Dudhat. Hopefully I said that correctly. Vinod talks about being into agriculture back in India, but after coming to Pennsylvania and needing a new career, he finds us, dental technology. After going through school, Vinod now owns his own lab that focuses on education for dentists.
You know, it's funny, when I was setting up his guest page on our website, I've actually been to his lab with Preet. I had no idea. It's like as soon as his website popped up, I'm like, God, that building looks familiar. And sure enough, I've met him before. Had no idea. And then we meet the fixed technician that learned to do dentures, all thanks to Ivoclar.
Shout out.
Brian Johns wanted to expand his offerings. And after learning about Ivotion in the PM7, and of course, with a lot of YouTube education, is now doing all on X with photogrammetry and the Easy Bar system and using reverse scan bodies to deliver fantastic digital finals.
And then Rob Fletcher stops by to talk about lean manufacturing. He comes from the automotive industry and after getting recruited, took on the task of cleaning up Knight Dental's process to make us more efficient and definitely better workflow. Rob talks about his passion for air conditioning tubes, getting into leadership, and how labs can eliminate waste, which is huge, and go to a one-piece flow and fine line balance. Something every lab should probably check out. Really was great for us.
So please join us as we chat with Michael Wandling, Vinod Dudhat, Brian Johns, and Rob Fletcher. Whether you're looking to elevate your craftsmanship or looking to cut back on cost, look no further.
VITA MFT teeth are the ultimate solution for creating lifelike and stunning smiles.
Crafted with precision and backed by cutting-edge technology, VITA MFT teeth offer unparalleled aesthetics and durability.
And since VITA believes in the power of experiencing excellence firsthand, for a limited time only, they are offering you the chance to get a complimentary case sample.
That's right, a full case, absolutely free. Just visit VITANorthAmerica.com/free MFT.
Don't wait any longer to start providing your customers a premium tooth at an economy price. Redeem your free case sample, and if you're ready to buy, VITA will even give you an extra 10% off discount by shopping online on their newly launched online store.
Join the VITA family today, and we appreciate your support of the podcast.
Hey, listeners.
Voices from the bench here. Let's talk about exocad.
We want to tell you guys about an amazing digital dentistry event coming up, and it's called exocad insights 2024.
It's 2 days, May 9th and May 10th,
on the beautiful Spanish island of Mallorca with our friends from exocad.
This is a fantastic educational event for all of you in the dental lab industry, and of course your clinical colleagues.
There will be keynote presentations for master dental technicians, digital experts, implant surgeons, lab owners, and more.
Plus, exocad software experts will run hands-on sessions so you can get to know the latest releases, including DentalCAD 3.2 Alefsina, which was released just recently. Visit the large CAD/CAM exhibition to network and see the latest innovations. And of course, there'll be a really fun opening night with a pearly white themed celebration.
Ooh, that sounds like fun. So please head over to the event website, exocad.com/insights2024, or the link on this episode's show notes.
Get your tickets before they're gone. Remember, that's exocad.com/insights2024.
And don't forget, Elvis and I will be recording in person from Insights 2024. We're going to be talking to all of the amazing speakers, exocad leadership, and attendees.
And as a loyal listener of the podcast, you can use promo code VFTB15 to save 15% off registration to what will be one of the greatest events of the year.
Greatest events of the year.
All right, ready? 3, 2, 1. See you there.
See you there. Nice.
Voices from the bench. The interview.
I know. Well, you've been doing it long enough. You better know how. Jeez.
Jesus Christ.
All right, here we are, Ivoclar Ballroom, the first recording of LMT Lab Day Chicago 2024.
And it's Mike Wandling, my A-team, CDT.
My A-team partner, Barbara.
What team do we have here? What's the dynamic?
Well, Barbara and I met each other probably 10, 12 years ago.
Yep.
Working on some projects with the NBC, doing some item writing reviews and...
It's hard work.
Like the questions.
You're talking about
for the
looking
test?
At hundreds of questions, revising them, rewriting them, punctuation, capital, you name it, and then writing questions.
Right, and it took a lot of sugar-free Red Bull to to keep going. That's for sure.
But we were the best at it, so we called ourselves the A team.
We were the best. We still are the best.
So the questions, the tests are already done. You're just revising them that long ago?
Updating them with, you know, as technology changes.
Oh, sure.
This has to happen every so many years to keep things relevant and updated.
100%, yeah.
And so they bring in some so-called subject matter experts that they thought that we we were qualified, and we were very honored to be part of the project.
I think we wrote a couple questions, and we got our names on there, questions written by.
Oh, really? Yeah. Are the questions still there? Do you know?
Yeah, I think so.
I would hope so.
What's the question, and what's the answer?
I have no idea.
C.
Is it multiple choice? I never know.
Yeah, it's all multiple
choice. Is it multiple choice? Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah. But since that time... You opened up a laboratory, is that correct?
Yep.
What's your lab called?
I had a laboratory called Horizon Digital Dental Lab for the past 7 years. And then we recently went through a merger with another lab in our area. called Summit, and now we are called Summit Horizon Dental Lab.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
That
thank
happened you. In a very short time.
Yep, and the main reason they had technology that we were looking to purchase, yeah. we had technology that they were looking to purchase, so it just worked out to be kind of a good marriage.
Was it a removable and a fix coming together, or...?
We were both full-service labs
okay.
already.
Oh, interesting.
It yeah. was more of, we were an in-lab, dental lab, and they were three-shape.
Oh.
And they already had talked about getting 3D printing, which that was going to be our next purchase anyway. So we ended up merging with them, and it's been great.
You still using in-lab, or is it all three-shape?
Yeah, we're
now?
Using every system that we have. In lab
oh.
and three shapes.
Oh, yeah. And probably exocad too.
Not yet, but okay. that's next on the yeah. on the horizon.
Nice. So when did you get into this industry? What? How did you get into it?
Back in 2001. It's interesting how I got into it because there was no real rhyme or reason. It was I was looking for a full time a full time job with benefits, and
you found one in
I
a
ended
lab.
Up I wow. ended up falling in love with the industry and all the technology that goes along with it. And long story short, you know, now I'm going on my 23rd year, and I love it.
But when you walked into the, I mean, why did you apply to a lab? Just because they had benefits? Or did you walk in there and say, this
I
is
knew
interesting.
A couple people that were going to dental school at the time.
Oh, okay.
And mm-hmm. so I just didn't have the grades to get for myself to become a dentist. So I'm like, you know what? That does sound very interesting. I'll look into that, and found out that Keller Labs in St. Louis.
Yep, yep.
That's right. I remember
that they
that.
Were hiring at the time, and got on with them, and went from there to owning my own lab for 7 years, and now I'm merged
now
with
you merged.
Summit.
Not so. Only that, but you became certified. I believe you are an examiner.
I'm a CDT examiner, yes.
What's your
that's
CDT
just a way
in?
To give back to the,
oh, I know.
The industry.
I get it.
I'm certified in crown and bridge, ceramics,
Jesus.
Implants,
he's an overachiever.
Complete dentures, and then next month I take my digital workflow.
Aren't you exam. A master by now?
Got to have five, so...
After this, you will be?
I will be.
Oh,
so.
That's cool,
oh,
Mike.
You'll be too big to yeah. be on this podcast at that point.
Never. No.
Wow.
No, I'm honored to be on this podcast, actually, because I listen to you guys all year long and love the shows, love the guests that you
that.
Have on. And,
yeah.
Spread the word. I get more and more people to listen to you
thank
guys.
You.
And,
thank you.
It's you guys put on a great show.
Which, out of all this tests you've taken, which one was the hardest?
Implants. That's just a guess.
See, everyone says that, but I think it'd be the easiest one for me.
I will say this. I started off as a fixed technician.
Yeah.
And at a large lab, you pretty much are either a fixed technician or a removable
sure,
technician.
Sure, yeah. You know, you got a role.
And
yeah,
so
yeah.
I got my first two in crown and bridge and ceramics back to back, and that was pretty easy for me because I was used to working in the fixed department. But I also wanted to learn how to do removable. And so I had a friend of mine just show me some basic things. I've watched some videos. And I actually was kind of self-taught on setting denture teeth.
Wow.
And
self-taught.
I knew
literally, you just sat down and were like, all right, I'm going to figure this out.
Yep, many hours.
Lots of YouTube.
Many mistakes, many hours. But it was just like... something completely different, a new experience that I'd never got to deal in before. And so it just inspired me to learn more and more about it.
But you were already at Crown and Bridge.
Crown and
so
Bridge and
ceramics.
So you kind
of got the philosophies, the occlusion, you know, you
right.
kind of knew where
and
you were going.
The implant exam has a part of it where you have to do a denture with that as well, implant-supported
oh.
denture. So I
that's
used,
why I say it's the hardest.
I took
me.
The implant exam after... the two fixed ones just because it was kind of like in between. You're still doing some fixed implant
work. I see what you're saying, yeah.
And then some removable, and then after the implant exam, I decided to go ahead and take my complete denture one.
And you
so which one was hardest?
I know.
I would say complete dentures just because it was still foreign to me.
Yeah. Wasn't
you know, it wasn't like I was still not super confident going into it, but I just made it a goal of mine to do it, and and I did it. So
nice.
So you know about the digital CDT, okay? Can you help our listeners, like, with what you need to know? What should you study? Mm-hmm. You know, because I know there's a lot of buzz. There's a lot of people wanting to take it. But, like, how do you study?
They just
Any
announced
advice?
The first group that passed. Didn't
I
they?
Know.
I saw that on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the interesting part of that is no matter what lab, big or small, you're able to take the digital workflow exam. And it doesn't matter if you have 3Shape, InLab, or ExoCAD.
Dental
you can
wings.
Use any of those systems to make this happen. There's a lot of, other than just the three different names on those systems, you know, once you get into it, some of it you have to download files. Some of it you're scanning. You're doing some printing. You're doing some milling. So it's a true digital workflow exam where you're really incorporating all the different aspects that go
it's
into it.
It's not just designing.
No, it's not just designing.
Interesting.
So
I did not know that.
It's really a truly kind of a CAD/CAM. You're designing and milling.
Yeah.
Or designing and printing.
Well, we want the credential to be at a higher level.
Exactly.
You know, so putting all these parts together, you do have to know several. Just like you were talking about with the implant, you know, having to know dentures and bars. And so I think the digital exam's got a little bit of a lot of things.
And one of the things that we were concerned about, I was fortunate enough to be on a task force that helped design the digital workflow exam over the past
That's
year.
That's got to be tough.
Yeah.
For sure.
But one thing that we wanted to make sure is that it wasn't a watered-down exam, because that was a big concern for a lot of current CDTs, is they felt like this was just going to be super easy and watered down, and that's not
the case.
Like
you do a little bit of everything, and it was just...
Yeah, it's just, I think, and I can't speak for everyone, but
sure.
You know, maybe a technician that learned the old ways... They don't look at technology as the same as somebody that's only been in the industry for 5 years.
Yeah,
you know,
makes
they,
sense.
It's just different generations. So there's generation gaps there. But so they kind of look at digital like, oh, that's easy. That's super easy. So we wanted to really make this exam a challenge.
Yeah.
I mean, and obviously, do you just design a crown, or do you do a crown, a denture, an abutment? All I mean, what do you do?
You do an abutment.
Without giving too much away.
No, they want it all. They want all the answers, and they want to know exactly what to do.
Well, I can just say this. There are some files that you need to import.
Yeah.
Where you have to print models, mill some crowns out. You also get...
More than one?
Yes.
Oh, interesting.
You also get a set of two other sets of models that you have to do analog where you're pouring them up, but then you have to scan those models. Then you have to design the restorations that go on those models and fit them up. So there, it's not just design, mill. There is a little bit of work where they're having to understand how to thin out margins and how to fit it up to a model and stuff. So just like a lot of other technicians that want to become CDTs, they may be a good waxer, but they don't know how to metal finish or... You know, so this is going to be an exam where they may be a good designer, but they don't know how to use a handpiece. Yeah. So it's going to force them.
It's going to force higher learning.
Exactly.
When I learned my ceramics, or when I studied for that, I had to learn how to metal finish and wax.
Right.
And so I completely agree with you. And these are skills that I never would have had. It still made me a ceramist, but in a different way.
It pushes you to. It kind of pushes you and forces you to go out of your comfort zone, which is always healthy.
Yeah.
But I'm sure a digital technician now is going, I got to pour a model.
Well, it's kind of the same thing maybe for a seasoned technician that wants to take this exam now where they're like, I have to scan a model?
Yeah.
You know, so
Makes
I
sense.
Think it kind
of
goes both ways. But it's very exciting. NBC is super pumped about this exam.
Where are you taking it? Are you taking it at your lab?
Yeah, I'll be taking it at the lab, and so I'm going to do a remote testing. I'll send it in, and, you know, I'd say by early April I should you know, be they'll release those, and
CDT. You should be a master.
And then you're
gonna
have
five. Then I'll be a so-called master. You know, it's funny, but
I will bow to you when I see you.
I'll come back, and we'll do another show.
Are you going to go for all of them? How many are there? You might
There's
as well.
Seven now.
There's ortho, right?
Yeah, so ortho, I'm halfway to the ortho exam. I've taken my written and ortho, but I still need to take the hands-on.
Sweet.
So that's going to be next. And then that just leaves partial dentures. So those will be my last two.
That should be an easy one for you, right?
But you don't do those, or do you do those? So you're
gonna this is like... Yeah. I may need to come down, and Elvis may need to help me with that. I don't know.
Not me.
Partial dentures is really foreign to me, especially metal frame partial dentures.
Oh, there's some good metal frame people out there. Okay. You could definitely get a lot of help with.
Yeah.
So lab day, what are you doing here? I know we're in Ivoclar, so you're going to go watch Jill Swafford.
Yep, going to watch her.
She's
first. Sit in on a couple printing seminars, and then – a friend of mine, Mandy Arena, she's doing a...
We know Mandy very well.
I told Mike, I'm like, Mandy and I are girl crushes.
Yeah, so tomorrow she's putting on a removable seminar from 1 to 3. And so...
She did a great job of taking it down to basics.
Oh, yeah.
Showing analog in a convention that's full of printing digital and designing. She's like, I want to keep it, you know, and I love that idea.
Yeah. Yeah, I was telling Barbara earlier that Mandy and we work together now, and
she with you now?
She's kind of reignited my passion. You know, I think when
you know she almost left the industry.
Yeah,
when you're
in it for so long, it's easy to just go through the everyday motions, you know. But seeing somebody as excited about about dental technology that she is. It's just like, wow, I forgot. Like, I miss having that passion. She's helped reignite that for me.
My son's done that for me.
Yeah,
honestly. Good. And Glidewell today, seeing him speak. Like, it was such an emotional experience to see such great leadership. So I understand.
Yes.
She's got him on Instagram.
Yeah, she's got me on. So I was just not, I don't know if it's because I'm a Gen Xer or whatever, but I was just not too
social
hip on the
media,
idea of being social media. You know, it's like I go to my kids' sporting events, and that's my social media right there. I'm constantly at games or practices.
Yeah.
But you know, she kind of inspired me to say, hey, get an Instagram page. She actually helped me set up an Instagram page.
What do you post, like your work?
There's a few pictures of work on there. I'm still kind of getting into it, so I'm still in my comfort zone of posting pictures of kids games and stuff like that.
Elvis has to show me.
But I'm starting to post some dental things on there too. So
excellent.
Nice. Well, Michael, thank you so much.
Yeah, this is an honor to
I had
to
no
be
idea
with you guys.
That the two of you wrote so many of the questions.
The A-team.
There you go.
A-team is reunited once again. So I want to thank you both for this opportunity and hope to do it again with you guys.
Oh, absolutely.
Good luck on the
exam.
When
you're a master, we're going to have you back on.
Okay, we'll do.
Awesome. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep. Bye. Here we are, the Ivoclar Grand Ballroom, LMT Lab Day 2024. We are joined by, oh my gosh.
I think he's going to have to pronounce it because I don't trust you. How do you pronounce your name?
Vinod
Dudhat.
Dudhat.
Yeah, Vinod Dudhat.
American Dental Designs out of Montgomeryville, Pennsylvania?
That is correct.
Nice. And you're showing me a Cal Lab, so you're a Cal Lab member.
Yeah, Cal Lab, yes,
yeah.
Exactly.
What did you think of that Cal Lab meeting?
It was great meeting. I am coming to Cal Lab for a long time.
Yeah?
And that was good meeting.
Yeah. What drew you to Cal Lab?
Cal Lab, generally, I attend on meeting and this open session. I love it.
Oh,
then we discuss, you know, in between the technician.
Yeah.
We can find out all about
all the good,
problems.
All the good stuff.
Yes.
Yeah, that's a great thing. So tell us about your lab.
Okay, I did actually education in India. I did agriculture, a master in agriculture science, and after that...
What kind of science?
Agriculture economics.
Oh, wow.
And work as a bank officer, like an underwriter and financing in agriculture sector.
Yeah.
like people are asking for loan for land development and tractors, trailers, all kind of equipment, dairy farming.
Oh, geez.
Dairy farming.
Yeah.
Wow.
How the hell did you get into teeth?
I was just going to say, how does that go into teeth? Help me understand that.
1988, January 30, I landed to U.S., and everywhere was snow. And I cannot
find... Well, you went to Pennsylvania, dude. I mean.
Oh, because yeah. It snows, agriculture was and different?
Yeah, agriculture different. I can find old dead tree, not leaves.
Yep.
That was my first experience.
Wow.
And I say I learned all tropical things, but I never had like experience in the like a North Pole, this
sure,
kind of
sure,
cold
sure,
weather.
Sure.
So then how did then, it lead you to the lab? Like, then, did you know somebody? Or?
Yes, then I decided within a couple months, and I need to change my profession to if I want to survive to this country.
Mm-hmm.
Because of I grew up in India, there's 70% population directly or indirectly depend on agriculture, while in U.S., less than 7%.
Yeah, so it doesn't make
and
sense, really.
Doesn't make sense, and majority incomes come from health industry.
Yep.
So I decided to jump into the health industry.
There you go.
And I found my first job in dental warehouse. And
a dental warehouse?
Yes, that was in Montgomeryville. That was a dental supply company.
Oh, okay. Yeah, like selling teeth, like denture
no,
teeth.
No, selling all dentist product, X-ray, and all kind of dentist supplies.
So to the clinicians. Dentists.
Yes. Yeah,
National,
gotcha.
National Dental Supply Company. It was used to be there. And I was picking up all from the shelf all this material. And one day I found this crown and bridge material, and I mean dental laboratory material.
Oh.
And you said, damn, this looks cool.
Then I said, what is this? And then one of my coworkers said, oh, this is the dental lab. You have to work behind the scene with dentists. And once I arrived within a couple of months with only $20, so...
Damn.
I cannot afford to have long-term education like 4 years for going for dental college or doing master program or something else. Then I decided to do 2-year associate degree course that was McCary School of Health and Science in Philadelphia.
Oh, okay.
And without vacation and holidays, you can finish 1 year and 6 months. So then I completed comprehensive course.
For dental technology?
Dental technology, yeah.
Wow. What did you think of it? Hard? It
wasn't hard at all because once education level is higher, so within 3 months, I was asking so many questions to my teacher, and he told me, become my associate and let's help to other students. And that's where I finished, and after 6 months, I was teaching dental assistant.
Oh, yeah. So you were that student. You were the smart one to ask a ton of questions and take over the teacher's role. And so you fell in love with it. You just liked it.
And within I had to pass my time most of the time, you know, in the school, because in the school, they teach one custom tray for 1 week.
Oh, yeah.
Bite block for 1 week, and that is too long.
way too long.
So I decided to, you know, finish my school 1 year and 6 months, and after that I joined. I was working 12 hours a day. I was working day times 8 hours in Crown and Bridge, and evening I was working in denture laboratory. And when I was in school, I was working in UPenn with orthodontic lab.
Oh wow, ortho?
Yeah.
At the university?
University of UPenn. There was John Kokovian Orthodontic Lab that was in University of Pennsylvania, UPenn.
Mm-hmm.
And I was working over there. And that's why I work ortho. I work in Crown and Bridge. And then I also did denture work.
Wow.
So in that short a time,
yes.
You learned every one of those skills?
I learned all skill within 1 year, all of them. And 1 year and while I was in the school. And back in 1990, December, I started dental lab.
Your own?
Yeah, my own.
That's the one that's now, American Dental Design?
I did corporation back in 1994. We made American Dental Design.
Wow.
Before I was using my last name, Dudhat Dental Lab, and I started myself 1990.
Oh, the name of the lab used to be your last name.
Last name.
And nobody could say it, right?
Nobody can say it.
Just like Elvis. We know.
And then back in 94, then I decided to make corporation and decide American Dental Designs. And I started 1994 around July.
And you were by yourself?
At that time we had 7 technicians.
Seven.
We've grown from 90 to 97, 7 technicians. And started 1994. And after that, we word of mouth and always just referred by the doctors.
Yep.
No marketing. And we've grown. And we become 20 technicians in 2010.
Wow.
And we bought another building, and we moved to 5,000 square foot area. And 2010, December 31st, we moved to other place.
Wow. Now, grow, grow, grow.
Now we are all together 35 technicians, I mean 35 staff members. Out of them, 24 technicians, other drivers. And
yeah, yeah, you got to have all that stuff, yeah.
So what do you like best now with all of the changes in the industry and all the different materials? Are you still at the bench, I should say?
I am still at the bench. I am doing a lot of QC, a lot of advising, a lot of teaching, and also I work with patients a lot. I am also helping a lot of dentists for solving problem for mainly dentists nowadays. They are not good in denture.
It's all removable. They need help.
Removable
with.
Thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So we have to help a lot.
Nobody goes chairside to help with a crown.
Yeah.
We all go to help with a partial or a denture.
So I can, you know, because of experience, I can judge and I can figure it out right away what patient have a problem, and I can solve problem very easily for any kind of denture related issues. But crown and bridge, everything, that's simple thing. So most of the people can do it. Yeah.
Sure.
Wow, it's pretty awesome. So are you looking for any new equipment here at Lab Day? We're with Ivoclar, so obviously you're going to watch some of their lectures.
So
but
we always need to update the equipment. Everything is keep changing. We have to adapt new technology and never say no. Something has to go expire and something has to come new one. It keep changing.
Yep.
Life is learning. Same thing, innovation is every day. We have to keep investing money and keep changing the technology.
Yeah. So how often do you change technology, do you think? Is it almost every year?
Every year, constantly.
Yeah. What are you looking for here, then? Anything in particular?
Not today, but we always, you know, all around, we don't wait for the convention show and for buying something.
Oh, yeah.
I used to do that before, not anymore.
Yeah, it's too long to wait a year sometimes. Yeah.
So we see technology, we wait a little bit, and we find out what is exactly going on, and then we jump into that and invest money into that. Because I did invest it many times, a lot of technology. I was first in Pennsylvania, like sculpture fiber core, and before that we did also art glass, and long time ago.
They mentioned that today at Cal Lab, art glass.
And, we also did Eclipse material from Dentsply, and certain material, Eclipse was not successful, and everything goes away within few years.
Sure.
You know, this one, everything
not
is
everything is a success, but I understand that.
So
are you doing digital dentures?
Yes, we do digital denture, but digital denture is still not, as per my opinion, I'm not still satisfied myself as compared to conventional acrylic denture. And aesthetic of that is, I still think best looking denture you can make manually, more labor work involved. But aesthetically, it looks nice.
Yeah. And I don't think we're far off, though. Yeah. From
it will improve. It definitely will improve. Digital denture must be good when we're doing milling, but that is cost is more higher, and it's not affordable for most of the people.
I don't know. I was walking down the exhibit hall earlier today, and a lot of 3D companies had their dentures out, and they're pretty nice. They're really nice. I mean,
time will come.
Yeah.
It will change.
I haven't gotten the pleasure of going down there yet, but I cannot wait.
It is a zoo. There are so many people here at this show.
Yeah. And it's Friday, so tomorrow's going to be twice as busy.
Yep. It's going to be fantastic.
And it is also convenient now because the Swiss Hotel is right next to us, and we have Kel Lab here, and this meeting is here, and this is 3 days.
It's nice.
It's three days of awesomeness, I've got to say.
And this LMT and all this thing in the 3 days, that's excellent, and that's the best show in the United States.
Yes, sir.
We're so
happy to be here. Oh, so happy that you sat down.
I have another question. I have a question.
Oh, sir.
Are you an MDT? Does that mean you have five specialties?
Yes, I did MDT with in NYU. That was a 20-week course.
Oh, I know about that.
Yeah.
So there's two. There's Master Dental Technician, where you get the CDTs, but there's also a course.
Yeah.
Yes.
Where you become a med.
Yeah. Then in MDT, they teach about all occlusal and a lot of other things, more details. So this is a 20-week course.
20 weeks.
Yeah. But
every day for 20 weeks?
No, every other week. You have to go every other week Saturday.
Yeah.
In the NYU, and also you do some homework at home too.
Man, do they still teach it?
Nowadays, I do not know. Last couple of years after COVID, I did not follow up. But before, and also founder, you know.
I'd love to go through that program. Wouldn't that be
great? So are you doing any digital yourself? Do you do any designing?
I do not design each and everything in more detail, but I do verify many cases. Some problematic comes, yeah. Some challenging cases require certain times some design.
They bring in the big guns.
Yeah,
right,
sometimes some challenge come, then I design myself because I need to know exactly how, what expands, yeah. And what can I, yeah. What strength I need. So I guide my technician. I can tell them this is the I need design. So it has to be. No,
these specs.
Does not break, yeah. And it has to be perfect processes for the patient.
Yeah, it's a lot of work. Yeah. I'm not a designer, but I think I should be because I think I'd really like it.
Yeah, I think you would. I think you'd be really into it.
Yeah, the smile design is actually that's the art of art, and also is considered engineering point of view. You need to understand the stress and how that will be successful, need to guide also to dentist sometime. Just for example, dentist place the four implants straight. And then doctor, the patient, dentist asking, oh, I want to do all on four fix.
Yeah.
We have to refuse. We have to tell them, no, you cannot do all on four on four implant when they are all straight implant.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
There's a peep, they need to understand, more detail about what is the angulation supposed to be. Just like we have a bridges, we have V formation, mm-hmm. like all the angles and all the scums.
Yeah.
So they need to understand that thing.
So you must keep yourself updated.
Yes.
Well, he goes to the Cal Lab every year.
Well, yeah.
That's the best way to keep updated on a lot of this stuff.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much.
It was awesome.
Thank you
for having me.
Have a great rest of the weekend.
You too. Thanks.
All right, Ivoclar Ballroom, Lab Day Chicago 2024, Brian K. John, CDT. What's happening, sir?
Good to meet you.
You know, we're in the Ivoclar Ballroom, and it's kind of where I started my journey with the All on Four.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. So I took a course with Daniel Alter probably 5 years ago.
Yeah?
And he told me how to, I'm a crown and bridge guy, and he told me how to convert a denture. I was horrified.
Yeah.
So it took me about a year to think about it, and then I decided I saw the Ivotion system. So
did you buy in?
I bought in.
Yeah.
I'm all in at that point.
So you got a PM7.
I got a PM7, so now I can do dentures, right?
Nice.
Yeah.
Any crown and bridge person can do dentures digitally.
Right now, yeah.
Smart.
Yeah. So, basically that's why I bought it. I was, pursuing this all on four. And so now I have a denture, and now I have to go convert a denture as a crown and bridge technician.
Yeah, how'd that go?
Yeah, what's that like? Did you have to teach yourself? Did somebody teach you?
Well, YouTube.
Like, YouTube.
Oh, yeah, we hear that a lot, honestly. Yeah.
So, I've been in the business. My father had a full-service lab. I know a bit, but I don't do acrylic. And so it was a whole experience, and fortunately, everyone propped me up. And,
yeah, sure.
And, just don't tell the patient your first time.
Don't let them know.
Yeah.
So, don't see them sweat.
So I got through it. It was a whole day experience. And at that point, I decided I never want to convert a denture again.
Really?
Yes.
After your first one, you were
too
done.
Much blood or what?
No, it was just too much work. And it was not accurate.
It's a lot of work.
It's not accurate. And so at that point, I saw article in LMT is leaving chair side conversions in the past was the name of the article.
Really?
Yes.
Hmm. That's surprising.
So that inspired me to go down that road and try to figure out how to do a digital conversion.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Sounds like you did.
It was fun, yeah. So I did a whole lot of processes. We were using scan bodies. And so the industry was telling me that wasn't accurate enough.
Photogrammetry.
Yeah. So, eventually I decided I went to a course with a prominent periodontist, and he trained me on photogrammetry. And it was amazing. But at that point, I'd already had surgeries lined up with docs that didn't have photogrammetry.
Mm. Yep.
So I'm like,
what do I do?
What am I going to do? Yeah.
Yep.
So
what'd you do?
What did I do? So I watched some more YouTube videos. Right?
Okay, yeah.
So I watched the YouTube videos. I saw Pinkus Sadar using the Easy Bar for his All on Four. So that kind of, clicked in my head that that was a great way to capture positions.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I still wanted to have a digital workflow. I didn't want the analog. I didn't want to do all the model work because where we're at in the industry right now. So I started thinking about it, and I'm like, why don't we put reverse scan bodies on the Easy Bar pickup?
Yep.
Do that chair side, take the verification process out of the general dentist's hands, and then all I do is I pre-design the case just like any good photogrammetry yep. guy would do.
Yep.
I have all my scans, have it pre-designed, and I'm waiting for that scan to come
sure.
in chair side with the trio scanner.
So the idea is they place implants,
mm-hmm.
patient's flapped.
Yep.
A bar you kind of can move around
well,
and adjust.
They have different sizes, so you can measure in between. You put your temporary cylinders on the multi-units
yep.
that are in place
yep.
at that point, and then you measure, you know.
The distance,
and then you can pick the size bar from the Easy Bar kit.
Okay.
That fits it, and then you can modify it if you need
yeah,
to.
Yeah, yeah, and then you loot it all together
loot
in the mouth.
Loot it together with some Stellar,
yep.
with light cure material. Then you take an open tray impression around. Picking the whole, unscrew it, pick it up with the impression. Then all of a sudden you have all your anatomical marks from the anatomy that we can line back to our pre-scans.
Yep.
So I put the reverse scan bodies
yep.
into the impression. I have the general dentist take their scanner chair side. Scan that.
Interesting, yeah.
And then send me that information. I'm waiting at the desk to,
yep.
to complete the design, take the trajectories, and then also to...
Then you reverse that into a model.
Yes, yes.
And then take your pre-designed full arch, adapt it to that
yep.
new model.
Yep.
And then what, you print?
I mill in the...
PM7, nice.
Out of Ivodent material.
Which is all tooth colored.
It's the yep. tooth color. It's yep. the tooth material for the Ivotion.
Yeah, yep. yeah.
So it's been a game changer because that PM7 is so accurate. So I know exactly the offset in microns to when I design these
yeah.
cases.
How quick do you get this thing back to the office?
I deliver it the next day.
Next day?
Yeah.
Wow.
I can mill a PMMA in about an hour and a half.
Oh, no kidding. That's
yeah,
not
it's
bad.
Pretty quick.
Yeah. Yeah. yeah, but you have it all ready for them. Patient yep. goes home. Patient relaxes.
Yeah, go chill out a little
yeah.
bit and come back the next day.
A little bit easier, a little less stressful on them.
And then all the general dentist has to do at that point is just screw it in.
Yeah,
check
do you ever do
inclusion.
Pink on it? Or
I do put some little composite on the facial.
Nice.
And I usually let the patients ride out about 3 months in the PMMA.
Smart.
So
let them heal a little bit.
Yeah.
You do the final?
Yeah.
Yep. And then before the final, after 3 months, the patients have worn their chewing patterns.
Their occlusion
in,
is
into
they
the
dial
PMMA.
It in themselves.
yes,
yeah,
yeah.
For sure.
So I have jaw motion.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So then I'm able to copy that and go straight to zirconia.
Nice.
Yes.
What All kind right. of zirconia are you using?
I use the prime zirconia.
And you love yep. it?
I do love
and
it.
And you are
yeah.
an Ivoclar fanboy.
Heck yeah.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
the most beautiful
it's a perfect
material.
Place, right?
yeah. yeah.
Certainly.
That's great.
And you find that all works out really well? No it, learning curve? I mean,
oh,
is there
you
been
know,
any
we
issues
have a,
along the way that you had to tweak?
Well, you know, fortunately, you know, I had to – you know, take this proof to concept.
Yeah.
So I had to prove that this was going to be passive within 5 or 10 microns, like a photogrammetry scan.
Sure.
Would be. So I'm kind of on the, I'm on the edge and I have to go to the surgery and, you know, I know it's going to work, but I have to, you know, go prove it.
Yeah.
And it works every time.
Are your finals going over tie bases or going directly?
I put them all on tie bases at this point. I'm not quite sold on direct to multi-use.
Can all of you I'm know that Elvis is an implant technician?
I kind of agree with that.
He knows
quite
more
sold
than me.
On it.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, maybe.
We got enough of them out there now. We're going to have to be sold or
yeah.
everyone's going to be screwed here
yeah.
in a few years.
No so. Pun intended.
Yeah.
yeah. What I like about the cylinders is that the doctors can verify that in an X-ray.
Whereas oh, good point.
You,
yeah.
If you go direct, it's hard for them to
yeah,
know how passive
sure,
that,
yeah.
that
That's a great point.
Is,
so. Gotta, metal's good for something.
Yes. Radio opaque, right?
So yeah. do you just do full arches all the time now? Or
I've been fortunate. I had a lab for, you know, 40 years. And I have a whole team that does crown and bridge. And I get to handle the implant department.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Where are you out of? So you're in
Nebraska.
Oh, gosh. Nice.
So I'm fortunate I have that kind of support.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So how big is your lab?
We have 7 people.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good size.
Yeah.
Having
yeah.
a lot of fun.
Oh, we have a great time. We have young CAD designers. It's just fun every day.
Yeah.
I feel that way, too. It's nice to be in an industry where you love everything every day.
Absolutely.
And especially like meetings like this. Are you looking at anything new?
Well, I think I have everything in place at this point.
Yeah.
You know, I love to have a facial scanner, a 3D face scanner.
Yep, yeah.
So I'm kind of looking at that a little bit.
Yeah. It's becoming more and more popular, especially if you're using ExoCAD, being able to bring their face into it.
And we do ExoCAD, and that the beauty of ExoCAD, it allows us to align those meshes exactly within microns.
Yep.
So we can selectively isolate points on our scans and mesh them.
That's awesome.
So how I hold my occlusion is with the glorified bite scan.
Okay.
Yeah. So we have an upper lower scan, all the extension of the tissue with the bite. That's my North Star. I can I'm always layering my scans back to that bite scan.
Got it.
So I can always control my occlusion.
That's cool.
So, but it's been a fun journey. Ivoclar has been great.
And yeah.
And the only reason I think I'm doing what I am is because of the denture software opened my eyes up to what's possible. And then
was it hard for you to get into digital after so many years of doing it analog? Was it something that was fairly simple for you to get into, or obviously you didn't resist it too much, but like what was that curve like for you?
The curve was 2001, the first CEREC in lab in the country, first 100. We were designing in 2D.
How'd that go for you?
We made a lot of copings and frameworks and stuff. Yeah. We were still stacking porcelain on top of it. Yeah, so we just had to make a 3/10 coping.
Yeah,
you know.
That's cool.
It wasn't terrible. But.
Awesome. Well, thanks for sitting down.
Yeah. Thank you for
this
having
is good.
Me.
Yes. Yeah, you were doing some good stuff.
I appreciate it.
Yeah. Enjoy the rest of the weekend.
Oh, thank you so much.
Yeah,
all right,
absolutely.
Have a good one.
Thanks,
so
much.
Bye. The Ivoclar Ballroom LMT Lab Day 2024. Rob Fletcher.
Yep.
Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much.
How
Elvis.
Are you?
I'm fantastic. I'm a little chilly, but it's a lot warmer here this year than it usually is.
Yeah,
so
for sure.
It was 60 yesterday. I go out there today, and I'm like, oh, my God.
But
it's got to be like 30.
You're both in Florida. So
yes.
Where is it at home right now? 95?
No, honestly, when we got here, it was 60 when I left Tampa, and it was 60 when I landed in Chicago.
That's
so
not right.
No, that's very, very rare. Very rare.
Every time we do our intros, he's like, "How is it hot? Is it cold?" I'm like, what do you think?
Normal.
70.
Yeah. Normally our heat's
30.
Gonna win.
Yeah.
So what dental lab are you from? I already know,
I am
but I'm gonna ask
Bay
you.
Bayshore Dental Studio in Tampa, Florida.
What is Bayshore?
Bayshore is a dental studio in Tampa, Florida.
Is it full service?
Full service, yes, sir. Yeah. We have everything from crown bridge removables. We really showcase our Bayflex flexible partial really, really heavy. We also have clear aligners,
you have
implants.
Your own brand of flexibles called Bayflex?
Bayflex, yep. It's a very flexible.
Traditionally pressed, or is it like milled or printed?
No, it's injection. It's
injection.
It's a TSC product.
Okay, and, yeah.
It's a great product, and all of our dentists really love it. Their patients love it more. So.
Yeah. So how did you discover teeth?
How did I discover teeth? Well, I think I was about 2 or 3 year old. They started coming through, and it hurt a little bit.
I was chewing on a waffle, and I was like, you know what? This is a little easier than it used to be.
Yeah, you know, that I'm sure a lot of your listeners are lifers in the industry, and I've met a lot of those way more than I ever thought I would. But, you know, I got a call one day from a recruiter over at Knight Dental, and now Lexier, and she said, I found your resume online. And was wondering if you wanted to come in and check out a job in our dental laboratory. And I said, you know, you didn't read my resume very well because I'm not a dentist. I didn't even know what a dental lab was. I thought she was wanting to know if I wanted to be a dentist. And I said, I'm from the manufacturing sector. My history is totally in Japanese automotive and working with manufacturing. So I don't know
like
anything
movie
about teeth.
With
Gung-Ho.
Gung-Ho,
It's not that far off of Gung-Ho, really. Michael Keaton's one of my favorite actors, and I do
that
love
that. You cannot make that movie today, you know that.
Yeah. It's a little, but no, it's really similar. The level of the strict discipline, self-discipline that exists in that industry is just intense. And
so what'd you do in that industry? I mean,
I started just on the factory floor.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but when I was 19 years old,
like riveting or whatever people
that
do?
Kind of stuff, yeah.
So, I don't know how you make a car.
Yeah, no, there's a few rivets in a car, I'm sure. the company I worked for, they made air conditioning tubes. And, you know, it's what's fascinating about manufacturing is every little thing that you are seeing when you look around was manufactured by somebody. Just like this industry with their teeth, I remember people would just get fascinated with the littlest details about the car part that they made because it was so personal. And
interesting,
And just from the knobs on your stereo to your door handles to all the engine, it's all made by somebody, and somebody put a lot of care in that.
Well, and whoever made the Subaru cruise control button, I want to appreciate them. It's a very nice button. It's
okay.
Very, I'm just joking.
That's good. I'm glad you're that passionate about your cruise control button. All right. Well, I was passionate about air conditioner tubes for a long time. And, you know, I was just 19. And it was my first, like, I call it my first grown-up job where it wasn't, you know, fast food or, you know, that part-time stuff.
Yeah.
A real, you know, 8 to 5 or 7 to 3 or whatever the hours were, and real benefits and 401k and all that stuff. So I was 19. I was really happy and thankful to get that job because it had some stability and better pay than the minimum wage stuff.
Sure.
So I just started there. You know, I think I just kind of worked my way into management. I always tell the story. I'm not going to use his name in case for some reason somebody knows him. But there was a guy that was working next to me, and he put in for a leadership job, you know, a frontline beginner level leadership. And he got the job, and I was thinking, man, that guy's kind of a doofus.
How did he get the job?
And now he's my boss.
Exactly.
And so the next couple of times a job for a promotion went on the board, I applied, and I like to say I must have got turned down like 20 or 30 times. But
oh, wow.
No, I think it was more like 4 or 5, really, but it felt like 20.
Yeah.
And so I just got into leadership, and I just really started falling in love with it, and I loved the fact that I could impact a larger team, not just, you know, doing my job, but I could help other people, you know, do their job, and I just felt just really gratified by doing the leadership role. And then throughout my career, and I just kept, you know, growing to the next level of management. And somewhere along the line, I got really something I'm very thankful for. I got trained in something called lean manufacturing. And I know, you know, I it's
which
normal
for totally
me.
Which we're totally diving into when you get done telling this.
Oh, good. so I love lean manufacturing. Lean
really?
To me is about, you know, looking at what you're doing and just trying to make it better by removing the waste. And, you know, I kind of just sometimes
geek out on it.
Yeah, but it's just kind of like removing the stupid shit.
I love it.
Why would you place something way over there when you need it over here? Why would you do that, you know, those extra things when you don't need to? Or why? And just questioning it and trying to improve it. I'm the kind of guy that, you know, you're walking around, you see a little puzzle on the table. I want to pick it up and try to solve it. So I treat my job the same way. And so I spent, 17 years doing that kind
of
stuff.
Of lean.
Yeah.
And what, you went... I mean, but obviously you went to different companies to do lean, or did you just...
You know, so my very first, I guess, 3 years initiation in lean, I had an opportunity to... I had a teacher that was a very special man, and he was actually part of the lineage of the, like, the birth of lean manufacturing.
Okay, yeah.
He didn't speak English very well, though, so I was trying to work through a translator. I was trying to understand what he's trying to teach me, and I couldn't get it very well. So what happened was I went to Barnes & Noble's, and I found a book, and it seemed to be connected with what he was trying to teach me. It was called The Toyota Way, and I started reading it, and it was about this guy named Taichi Ono that came over to the U.S. and learned what the Ford Motor Company was doing, and he went back to Toyota, and it was, you know, before Toyota was ever even a car manufacturer. They weren't even, well, they were, but they just weren't a competitor to anybody.
Yeah,
they were just a small little company, and he identified that Toyota would never be able to compete with Ford because Toyota didn't have the resources that Ford did, so they needed to figure out a way to do it with less waste, less costs, smaller footprint, less material, less labor, all taking all the waste out of the process. And that's how they got their start, with a very waste-free manufacturing process. And, you know, Ford had tons of money, already capital, and already a lot of real estate and a lot of buildings and all that stuff. So I'm reading about this guy named Taichi Ono, and I take that book into work, and I said, you know, this Taichi Ono guy, well, he was brilliant, and this book's all about his system. And the Japanese teacher that I had, his name's Mr. Ito, he said, oh, Ono-san, that's my sensei. and I was like, you're kidding me. I'm reading this great book, and this brilliant guy.
He
was your teacher, right?
Wow.
So I was like, okay, now you really got my attention, as if you didn't before. So I just dedicated the next 3 years to learning everything I could from that man, and he taught me a lot, and he's kind of like my work dad. You know, he raised me. And I learned a lot of lessons from him.
And then night calls.
Yeah, I was going to say, so night calls, and you implemented one-piece flow at our laboratory. So
damn.
I'm sure our listeners would love to hear about.
So how unlean was night when you walked in?
Pretty damn unlean.
Yeah, I see, that's the thing. When I got out of automotive and I started working with other non-automotive companies, it was shocking to me that everybody didn't know about this. So, you know, it's not a matter of not being lean. It's just never been exposed to what was just normal in my Japanese automotive background.
Yeah.
And every, you know, all the things that I've learned throughout my learning time there, it's really just about being able to understand what your opportunities you have and what the biggest issues are, and then applying the right solution to that. And when I walked into Knight, I remember getting a tour. It just seemed like, here's the milling room over there, and there's the model room over there, here's CAD, and everything was all spread out, and there was lots of inventory in between, and everybody was running everywhere trying to find a pan.
Yeah.
And, you know,
oh yeah.
My gosh, we're so far behind, and that didn't go in the oven, and we have to ship it today. And it was just all these problems. And me drawing from my background, I'm saying, well, you know, it's a real natural, obvious solution that's been solved 75 years ago by the automotive industry. You don't do things in huge batches like that. You should try to streamline your manufacturing flow. And it took a bit to convince everybody that it was a good idea. I will tell you.
Yeah, because you know how much we love change.
Honestly,
right?
You know what? I got
that was tough.
Here's where a big piece of credit goes, is I remember sitting down next to Barb and I was pitching her idea, and she was like, hey man, that's what you know, that's what you're good at. You go ahead and do it. I'll do what I'm good at. You do what you're good at. And we made it was a great partnership.
And she said, as long as you change nothing
about what I'm doing,
I'm happy with whatever you do.
Oh, yeah. We tried moving her desk 3 inches to the left, and she fought me every now. We had to convince everybody it was a good idea, and that's always a fight. And you know, I had
so what
to
did
do
you
training.
Change? I mean, did you move departments?
Everything.
Everything?
Every single damn thing in that factory moved.
Oh, my
gosh. And we did some training first. What I did was I bought a bunch of Legos and I did a simulation.
You have my attention.
Yeah, right. we made a, you know.
It was pretty cool, though.
I fabricated this training where we made a tooth, and me not really knowing.
Out of
much.
Legos?
Yeah. It was okay looking.
Yeah,
tooth,
yeah, I get you.
And I made these work instructions, and what we did is we set up the process around the table with different people, and I made sure Barb was one of them. And we set up around the table, and I made sure actually Barb had the longest process because I don't know. Maybe
son
I was
of
just,
a.
Yeah, I know. So we did it the traditional way, like departmental batch manufacturing. You're doing a bunch of batches, and you're moving to the next department doing a bunch of batches, and we timed it, and we had observers, and then we adjusted it to one piece flow, and that's basically instead of, you know, manufacturing big lots and big batches and moving to the next department, you bring everything together and you just have one case flow to the next operation, and then just keep on moving like a river, like flow.
So like, here's the model, and then he's sitting right next to the die trimmer. Mm-hmm. They hand it to the scanner.
I mean, they literally
which
just
is right
it
next
over.
To him.
Yes,
the
sir.
Scanner scans
so
it.
So instead of doing a bunch and putting it on a cart and mm-hmm. wheeling it to the
yeah,
other
exactly.
side.
Yes.
Right. So I don't know why. I mean, a long time ago, Henry Ford and his manufacturing system was over there as the stamping department, and they make a bunch of products and move it to the welding department or whatever. And
yeah, yeah.
That's where Taichi Ono came over and said, we can't afford that waste. What we're going to do is we're going to have a stamping press right next to a welder, right next to a painter, you know, and it just kept on flowing. That way, imagine how less inventory was in there,
sure.
How fast it is to move it from
beginning
department
A,
B, C, right. Yeah. We could literally move a crown through there in 24 hours where previous would take, you know, 5, 6, 7 days because you just start it and you never let it stop. And
interesting.
It's pretty
yeah.
cool.
And yeah. and it was, and I got a bunch of.
It was very successful.
So does a technician ever have more than one case pan in front of them, or is that the idea?
The idea would be the attempt is to make it no, just one
yeah.
at a time. But in reality, it. Because of the nature of the work, yeah, there are usually a couple around that person, but it's not like it's carts and carts and
no,
all that
yeah.
stuff.
So yeah, yeah, sure.
And it just keeps moving. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's pretty. Yeah.
But you have to do stuff in batches, sort of, because like you're doing centering. Like you're milling certain shades at one time yep, and yep. that kind of thing.
And that's where the compromise comes in. What the idea of doing this kind of thing is about is not doing it because there's a few constraints. It's doing it wherever you can and then dealing with those constraints and as whichever way you can. And yeah. so we greatly reduced the inventory, say, like Barb was saying, like from model work. Of course, you know, I can't remember what the number was, but they would pour up 15 models and then they would have to set for 45 minutes or whatever. So there was a batch there. There yeah. No, we're not going to have one, of course. So when they would shuck those models and pass it to the die trimmer and articulators, they would just do it as fluidly as they can and then put it right into the scanning machine. From the scanning, it would go into design, and the designs would come back, and, yeah, they would get batched into a puck of shades. Yeah. We wouldn't do one at a time. But then from there, it goes right into the mill. So it was really a U-shaped production yeah. line.
Interesting.
Where before there was, you know, the model room over there and the milling room over here, we took one model person and sat them next to one die trimmer and sat them next to one scanner and sat them next to a couple of mills, actually yeah. three mills. And then when they came out of the mills, of course, there were three centering ovens in the line. And then they would take what came out of those, you know, 25, 30 units that coming out of a mill and put them right in the oven. Then however many hours later it came out of the oven, then they would go into seat and finish and stain and glaze kind of one at a time.
So are we less time, mm-hmm. yeah, less material? Inventory.
Should
less
be,
remakes
be. You know where I mean, you know the biggest thing I think that really impact, and you know there's a big rule when I'm doing lean activities, is that you don't want to ask for a bunch of people to help you implement something and then the next thing you do is figure out you're leaner so you need less labor and then you fire people.
Yeah,
that's a
yeah,
bad
yeah.
news because then okay, who wants to help me do the second project? Nobody. Yeah. Nobody.
No.
So, but what it does is it allows you to very, precisely plan your labor.
Yeah.
Now, some of it also, you know, what I didn't mention was you're now able to do what's called balancing your workload.
Okay.
And I don't know if this is an okay story to tell, but it's kind of.
We love stories that start
yeah,
that way.
Oh,
yeah.
I don't know. It goes into the Barb a little bit, but honestly.
All right. Now
no,
I don't
no,
know.
Not bad. It's actually, honestly, at the time, we finished, you know, one of the guys in the lab helped me put together the first production line. And I was really surprised that day. Bob Warner, you know, the founder yeah. of Knight Dental, happened to be in the lab that day. And it was not often that he was there, but he happened to be there that day. And we had not done anything. We had not put one person on the line yet. And I thought, well, what better person than an honorary, you know, the founder of Knight Dental to be the first person to sit down. And he grabbed a handpiece and started doing some die trimming.
That was pretty cool.
I got a
picture of that.
I nice. Know. It is a picture. But I will tell you, here's where the funnier part comes in. As part of this process, you do something called line balancing. And that's where you want everybody on the line to have an equal amount of time worth of work. So,
well, yeah, it doesn't work if one
right,
person takes four right. hours and another
yeah,
person takes 20 minutes.
It's really
yeah.
down into minutes, right?
Yeah,
so,
yeah, sure.
So when I was going through and I was looking at the original process, I realized that, you know, there was die trimming, which was, you know, say 3 minutes of work or whatever. And then there was sectioning the die, which was like 1 minute worth of work.
Yeah.
And now everybody else on the line had like 5 minutes worth of work. So what I did was I said, okay, we're gonna have to give this die trimmer a similar amount of time as the rest of the people on the line. So what
how
we're
going to do that?
We're going to have the die trimmer section their own die.
He wasn't thrilled.
Bob didn't like that
no,
at all.
No.
he kind of stormed off the line. He was like, yeah, I can die trim a whole lot more if I'm not die trimming. He was a little hot
at
me.
He was a little pissed.
I was like, sorry, and I'm not going to argue with you.
Yeah,
though.
Yeah.
Barb's dad, you're the founder of the thing. I was a little intimidated by that. But yeah, that's really – going back to what line balancing does, is it gives you an opportunity to just efficiently plan your labor for your line.
Yeah.
Where if you think about, let's say what your example was, if it takes you 2 hours to do this process and 5 minutes to do this process, that means, you know, the person that has a 5 minute process can either build up a bunch of inventory and then what is that person supposed to do?
Yeah. Yeah. Now
or
just sitting there.
Yeah. Or, you know, that 2 hour person, you know, they're struggling to keep up. So what it does is it allows you to very efficiently balance the labor in your company and in your process. And you end up, what we did was we designed these three production lines and we took everybody's name and we said, okay, let's put them into the line.
Yep.
And who is going to fit this the best? And then there was a whole list of names left over on the side because they just didn't fit. But the line was actually able to produce just as many units as it was before.
Yeah, more.
But with less labor because the labor was now utilized properly. So that's usually one of the biggest things that you can get out of that, plus the faster flowing, less inventory buildup.
How long did this process take?
Well, I think it took longer to convince everybody it was okay than it was actually
really?
Do it.
Yeah. It was a nightmare.
But they hired you to do it.
But people
Why was it?
It was okay. One of the all right, the Japanese word for small improvement is something called Kaizen. And there's a big saying in lean manufacturing, you want to do Kaizen with the people, not to the people.
Yeah, that
so
makes sense.
So when you do it with the people, part of that is gaining their trust, training them, getting their buy-in, because they really have to help with the entire process. Otherwise, they're going to reject and it's not really going to work. So I did a lot of training and worked really hard to convince everybody. So we got moving on it. And then some of the people that I was not successful at convincing started complaining that I was putting the mills in with the production line and there was a big fight about dust. And I just couldn't understand it because I was like, you guys are working around the mills anyway. It's not the first time. I'm not introducing dust. The dust was already here. You just don't like that I'm moving it closer to you. But nonetheless,
we got through it.
And I think, it's been a long time since we did that. But I wanted to think we did the first one in April and the last one in August. And we did three production lines. The first one was a test line or a pilot line, and it worked very well. And it was nice because we got to kind of isolate. Oh, I'm really enjoying talking about this. Every now
and then. We know. I love
Don't. I'm shy normally. I'm an introvert.
I find this fascinating.
I know. I can tell.
Oh yeah,
I do too.
It's a very. I really gravitate towards leadership. But I'm also an engineering type brain, so I love leading engineering type events. And this is really one of those, you know, scientific,
so
mathematical.
Knight's a big lab. Could smaller labs do this?
Anybody can do it.
I think so, absolutely.
That's what is so funny is people tell me all the time that, gosh, Rob, what you do won't work here because that's only an automotive thing. I have sat next to people in government, railroad, postal, any walk of like anything, it doesn't even have to be so much work. I mean, it doesn't have to be work. You can implement lean manufacturing at home just like by looking around.
Don't tell my wife.
I know, right? but lean isn't just about one piece flow. There's so many other facets to it, but just taking a look at what you're doing and reducing the waste in your process.
It literally flipped our financials.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, we made a lot of money, changed the percentage, and it was
still
doing really
all
successful.
Of it? I mean, you're still doing all the lean?
Yeah.
I think so. I'm not there anymore, but I think so.
Are you doing lean at the new place?
In a different way.
Yeah.
In a completely different way. Like I said, that one of the mistakes that I think people make about lean is they hear, I heard Rob talk about lean on this podcast. Let's go do exactly what Rob did in our place. And it doesn't always make sense because if one piece flow isn't a solution to your problem, like if your problem isn't going to be solved by one piece flow, then don't do it.
Yeah, lean is not a one answer.
That's right.
Solution.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah.
Some of you know, like,
you got to really dig into what's going on.
And there's all kinds of different things you can research out there online or in a book or a magazine or training videos, YouTube. You can find this stuff out anywhere. It's the real trick is understanding enough about your environment and understanding which tool you should apply to your biggest problems.
Yeah.
And that's
crazy because Glidewell was kind of talking about that today.
Oh, he's got to be the master.
You got to segue into Glidewell.
I
we love him.
Just got done talking to him. But bumped into him in the lobby and I just have such a work crush on the guy.
Did you lean into him?
Oh, that's cute. That's cute. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Look who's being funny now.
Pa-dum-pumps. Yeah. He I was just walking through the lab. Yeah, there was not a dry eye in that room. And I told Barbara, I said, I'm emotional. I can't even explain exactly why I'm emotional. I'm misty-eyed. I'm touched. I'm warm inside. The guy's just amazing. I can't say enough about Jim.
So are you going to do this for teeth forever, or do you think you'll go back to any other industry?
Who knows? I mean, I don't know. I'm a little different than maybe you guys or a lot of your listeners. I don't care, but it doesn't, like, I don't feel like I was born for
dentistry. Yeah, you can do this for other industries.
Yeah, and anywhere where it makes sense. I do know that I will always be looking for opportunities to improve, you know, whatever situation I'm in,
sure,
whether that's even work or personal or, you know, anything. I just like seeing things get better.
So, obviously, you know Barb.
I do.
You know the podcast.
I do.
How could we lean this podcast?
Yeah, I'm not going to tell you about that.
Unless we get rid of one of us, if
I'm
that's
just saying.
What we're talking about.
Yeah, right.
Wow. No, it's you, not me. I'm sorry.
All right, everybody. That was great knowing everybody.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Yeah,
we've been wanting to interview
great.
You for quite some time.
Well, I really didn't know what I was going to talk about. Now I don't feel like I was shutting up at all.
No, I loved
zoom,
it.
Zoom.
I love it.
We love that.
It's a hot
me.
Topic. It came up at CNC. It came up at Cal Lab. I'm sure people are talking about it here. I think it's important.
Oh, heck
yeah. Yeah, and I think if companies are really going to do it seriously, it's important to pick somebody that's going to lead the event. I see companies all the time say, okay, we're gonna adopt Lean, and they might do a little training on 5S or something simple, and then, you know, tell everybody clean up your workstation, and they go out and they clean up their workstation once. But I'm talking, you know, I think it's really beneficial for companies of all, you know, walks of life to really invest in a person to really get deeply trained in it. Whether that's, you can self-train a little bit, you can seek out, you know, I'm not huge on consultants, but you can always, you know, there's always an opportunity, a place to learn whatever you want nowadays. You know,
it's
not like you have to go to the library and find a book, or even like I did. It was year 2000 when I found the Toyota Way, and so much is available to us now. But dedicating your company to doing it would require some, you know, some dedication.
In your book, The Rob Way, comes out with
The Rob Way. Right. You know, I've always wanted to write a book. I've started writing a book several times.
Yeah.
Because I do think there's a hole in the market for Lean. Uh-oh, we got a heckler here.
Tony Prespettino with a lighter.
He's a fan. Uh-huh. We love him. That's what happens when it's live, right? You get all this.
Everybody
all
just
this
pops
going
up.
On.
Rob, thank you so much,
thank
man.
Thanks, Elvis. Thank
I
you,
I think
Barb.
That was interesting.
Good.
Appreciate it.
All right. All right. Thank you.
Yeah, we'll
thank
talk to you.
You
later.
Okay, bye.
A huge thanks to Michael, Vinod, Brian, and Rob for taking time out of your busy craziness of Lab Day Chicago and visiting us in the Ivoclar Ballroom. It is really and was so great to meet and talk to so many people that we might not get a chance to meet until we get to a large show like Lab Day. So it sounds like everybody on this episode is doing something amazing in different ways. And you guys, that's one of the reasons why our industry is unbelievably great. And we can all succeed in our own way.
All right, everybody. That's all we got for you. We'll talk to you next week.
See ya.
Bye.
See you in Spain. Dig right in. I got kids, I got cousins, I got shit everywhere.
The views and opinions expressed on the Voices from the Bench podcast are those of the guest and do not necessarily reflect the official policy or position of the host or Voices from the Bench, LLC.